how do you sort of keep your wits about you in a crowd like this? Because I'm sure that even just making it through the Javits Center is like a spooky thing in itself.
They have a pretty excellent system down of kind of protecting us. I think that usually the toughest Comic-Con is in San Diego because that's usually pretty crazy. And they do sort of put us out in the floor there, and that's when it's the craziest because you can feel just rows of people pushing against the security. So you sort of feel the energy of all that pushing against, and you're going, okay, I'm barely scooting through right now.
Like you're actually, your feet are off the ground, you're just like being hovered.
Okay. But it's also really cool because it means people like the show.
Yeah.
You know, it's
yeah.
coming from such a good place. So we're all really happy that people are that passionate about the show.
Oh, we were talking about that earlier, like how rabid the fan base is for Once Upon a Time. I mean, do you do the whole like live tweeting along with the show? Do you get involved with all that?
I do some of it, usually for the season premiere and stuff like that. It is a really nice way to feel like you can connect with people who are watching every week. And those are the fans that are watching it live. And, you know, that's such an important thing for the show. So we all kind of try to take turns doing the live tweeting and doing like Ask Jen or Ask Ginny or whatever, you know, so that people get a chance to connect with everybody.
And folks who are better versed on the storyline than we are telling us that your character is taking a very dark turn and very interesting things are happening with her. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yes. So at the end of season four, in order to save everyone, in order to save Regina and the town and her whole family, Emma took on the darkness. So the darkness had been released from Rumpelstiltskin, who had been the Dark One since the beginning of the show. And now Emma is the Dark One. And so we now have this character that has this incredible capacity for light because she was prophesied to be the savior and all this, but she now is dealing with being consumed with darkness. So there's this internal struggle that's going on. And we jump between time during season five between her struggling as to whether or not she's going to give into the darkness and her having totally given into the darkness. So we jump back and forth between those two points in time.
Was this something that you were just waiting for? Like anytime you get a script, you'd be like, and any page now, the darkness will be here. Cause that's kind of how the show goes, right?
Yeah, it is kind of how the show goes. People always laugh at us when we're having conversations because we have very serious conversations about curses and magic and the way certain magic happens, the way other magic happens. And sometimes people will catch us in these really intense, heated conversations about the logistics of magic. And people are like, what are you talking about? Like, listen, this is serious business.
Or you're like, oh, Rumpelstiltskin. God. Yeah.
I did know sort of by, I think kind of by the end of season three, they were planning this. But they were always planning it to have been something that started in season five. So I kind of had a sense of when it was coming. I wasn't exactly sure how it was going to end up there.
Has the show made you a fan of fairy tales or someone who just cannot deal with like a fairy tale? Like you do not want to hear any more about fairy tales in your outside life.
I've done, you know, the show, because of the show, I've done extensive reading about the psychology of fairy tales.
Huh.
And it's actually made me really appreciate fairy tales in a different way. Because obviously all the Disney movies and all those, the Pixar films, that's all fun, you know, and we all have childhood memories of that. But we don't necessarily know why we have such strong connections to the characters or what they mean to us at the time. And why certain ones stay with us through our whole lives and other ones we kind of forget about. So I've read all this stuff about the psychology of fairy tales, and different psychologists have different takes on things, but really they're about self-identity, and there's so many intricate, subtle things about psychology and your inner life and your self-growth and self-awareness that's all woven in there that you don't necessarily, well, you definitely don't realize as a kid, but you don't necessarily even think about as an adult. So having done all of that research actually has made me really appreciate the complexity of what fairy tales mean in our lives.
And I would say that they're also like a little bit darker, because I haven't like read fairy tales in
way
a long
darker.
Time. And then when you go back, you're like, oh, that person's like eating someone, or like, that's weird.
Yeah.
That witch is really bad.
But that's
or,
why they get away with it, is because it's always symbolic. It's like, it's why a parent always dies in a fairy tale, because it's supposed to be the child's opportunity to imagine themselves without their parent being their identity. So it forces a kid to go, what would I do if my parents weren't there? And then it's supposed to encourage that self-growth. So there's like purpose in all of it, all of the violence and the darkness, but it is dark.
It's dark.
I mean,
it's
just for sure.
Some of the ones I've gone back and read, I'm like, whoa.
There's a lot of children being eaten.
A lot. Yeah.
It's a thing that pops up a lot in fairy tales.
It's very in nowadays.
Very, very in.
It's very weird.
Is there a character that you've discovered in your research that you're like, this would be a great character on Once Upon a Time, or someone to be brought in maybe?
I don't know so much. Interestingly, like the older fairy tales, the characters are a bit more generic. They're more representative. So there's an old fairy tale that I have been sort of using as a reference for Dark Swan, which is the Queen and the Murderer. And so it's not like, you know, you don't have like a Cinderella or whatever. It's just called the Queen and the Murderer.
Classic kid stuff.
Yeah, the Queen and the Murderer is so, so good for kids. There's just interesting parallels that are going on where this woman is sort of haunted by this murderer for her whole life. Her father hadn't believed her when she was a kid that this guy was threatening her, and she ended up having to hurt him to protect herself, and then she got in trouble for hurting him to protect herself, and then he haunts her for her whole life until she finally stands up to him and actually has to kill him. So I know this sounds super dark, but interestingly, it sort of represents the way the darkness is in Emma's life right now, where she's been sort of haunted by this darkness and it's been following her. And so now, for me, I'm looking at it as a parallel of how does she then stand up to this amount of darkness that has been put inside of her, and how does she face it and overcome it? You know,
it's like Fight Club.
It is actually
like Fight Club.
Well, and it's funny you say that, because I don't know if you've been watching it or not, because you're saying people were telling you about this. I actually seem to be talking to myself a lot, because there is an apparition of the old Dark Ones that appears to Emma. So I've spent most of the season sort of talking to myself. So there is a very Fight
Converted.
Club.
I'm in.
Very Fight Club element going on.
That's the best kind of collaboration when no other actors are involved.
Yeah, it's exactly. Like, let me just work with me. Thank you.
It's a lot of memorizing.
Yeah, I was going to say. Well, in fact, I was going to ask you too, because since your character has gone through these transformations and is still going through them, we've talked to actors like Billy Brown, for example, mm-hmm. on How to Get Away with Murder on mm-hmm. your network, who was telling us he doesn't even read the script before he sits down at that table script. He has literally no idea when he's turning the page when it's his turn to say something. He wants it that fresh. Do you want to know your character's arc beforehand, or are you happy to discover her along the way?
I like to do a little bit of a mix. I definitely I like to sit down with Adam Horowitz and Eddie Kitsis, who are the showrunners. We always sort of have check-ins where we talk about bigger sweeping arcs and things that are going on, because a lot of times for our storytelling, our characters will know something that other people don't know, but we don't know that we know it yet. So there's sometimes it's really important to have some of that information, because it really does impact the way that we're giving a performance. And it's not about discovering it in the moment. It's that if you don't know it, then you just look like an idiot later. So there's a certain amount of information that I like to have in terms of the bigger arc. And then the day-to-day stuff is nice to keep a little bit fresher, because then you do have those spontaneous moments and you do have that discovery that's a little more, I guess, spontaneous.